Have you heard? So many people have died yesterday, and many have tested positive again. I feel so disturbed by all the news and information. This COVID has totally devastated our lives. So what is this COVID-19?
Yes, I totally agree with you. It feels like the world has come to an absolute standstill. The coronavirus disease 2019, as you were asking, is also known as the COVID-19.
Okay, I see. What is the cause of COVID-19?
The COVID-19 disease is caused by a virus that was first reported in December 2019 in Wuhan, China.
And why is it referred to as a pandemic?
Yes, you know, they call it a pandemic, a disease when it spreads across the world, infecting a large number of people across countries and continents.
Now that I have understood what a pandemic is, do you know of any other past pandemics?
Yes, there have been some deadly pandemics in world history. Majority of these pandemics were caused by viruses, like the smallpox and Spanish flu. A pandemic which was caused by the bacteria was the bubonic plague.
So in majority of the pandemics, viruses have been the major culprits. What makes a tiny virus so dangerous?
A tiny virus can be very deadly. Viruses have DNA or RNA as their genetic materials. The SARS-CoV-2 is an RNA virus which uses the infected person's cells for multiplying its numbers. While making more copies of the RNA, certain errors can arise, and SARS-CoV-2 lacks the ability to correct these errors. These errors give rise to mutations that result in new variants or strains of SARS-CoV-2. At times, some variants spread faster and cause more severe disease than their parent virus. The SARS-CoV-2 is mutating rapidly and giving rise to new variants that are causing multiple waves of the COVID-19 pandemic across the world.
So you mean to say there are different variants of SARS-CoV-2? What are those?
Yes, many new variants of SARS-CoV-2 have been identified till date that have arisen due to different mutations. You may have heard some of their names, like the B.1.1.7, the alpha variant, the B.1.427, and the more recent B.1.617, the delta variant, and the P.1 variant.
Okay, so how do these mutations help viruses in infection?
That is a very valid question. When the virus infects a person, it triggers the immune responses in their body. In an immune response, a person produces antibodies against the viral particles or proteins that neutralizes the effect of the virus. Compared to other viruses, the SARS-CoV-2 delays triggering of an immune response in the person. The new variants of SARS-CoV-2 have mutations in the spike protein that increases the transmissibility or spread of the virus. The triggering of an immune response to the new variants is delayed, and this helps the virus to infect and spread to more people.
Can you explain me why did the second wave of COVID-19 happen in India all of a sudden?
Since you brought up this question, I think the second wave hit India more drastically as compared to the first wave, because there was a laxity in the COVID appropriate behavior, contact tracing, and containment guidelines.
I am very curious to know, how does this COVID-19 infection spread?
The COVID-19 spreads through droplets carrying SARS-CoV-2 virus, which can spread, number one, when an infected person talks, coughs, or sneezes in front of healthy, unmasked people in crowded areas within a distance of 6 feet. It can also spread if somebody touches contaminated surfaces and then carelessly touches their nose or mouth with their soiled hands.
Okay. Now, if a person gets infected, what are the target organs that get affected by the virus and why?
The virus binds to a protein called the ACE2 receptor that is present on the cells in the human organs, and it enters inside the cells to multiply and make more copies of itself. The important organs that express ACE2 receptors are the lungs, heart, blood vessels, kidney, liver, and intestine. If the infection is left untreated, the virus can severely damage these organs. This virus, upon infecting the cells of these organs, causes them to swell. Activation of circulating immune cells in the organs leads to rapid increase in the levels of cytokines that cause widespread inflammation in them. These cytokine proteins are known to call more soldiers or immune cells at the site of infection to actively fight the COVID-19 infection. As a result of accumulation of more and more overly active immune cells and further cytokine secretion by them, a condition known as cytokine storm occurs. This leads to multi-organ damage. The virus also infects the cells of the digestive tract, causing symptoms like nausea, vomiting, and diarrhea.
How does the virus damage these organs?
The human lungs have air sacs called alveoli, which when infected lead to a decreased supply of oxygen in the body, which in turn affects all the other organs.
Is there a particular organ which is more severely affected by COVID-19 infection?
The human lungs are the organs which are the most severely affected because lungs contain a large number of ACE2 receptors, which increases the number of virus particles entering the lung cells. The virus reaches the alveoli in the lungs through the nose and the windpipe. In case of severe infection, extensive lung damage occurs with lung scarring. This can also be visible as opaque ground glass patches on the lung X-ray.
Can you tell me what happens when the lungs get infected by the virus?
The immune system fights the SARS-CoV-2 virus infecting the alveoli by moving protein-rich fluid into the alveolar spaces, which results in filling up and blockage of alveolar spaces with lots of dead cells and mucus. This makes the alveoli incapable of adding oxygen to the blood and removing carbon dioxide from it, and leads to a dangerously low oxygen level in the blood, a condition which is known as hypoxemia. This is often seen in COVID-19 patients requiring oxygen and ventilator support.
Does this infection affect people of all age groups?
Yes, the SARS-CoV-2 virus can affect people of all age groups. People who are above the age of 60, who often suffer from other diseases such as diabetes, high blood pressure, and people with pre-existing lungs and cancer, have a weakened immune system, which makes them more likely to get severely affected by the COVID-19 infection.
I have heard that children were less affected than adults by COVID-19. Why is it so?
Scientists believe since children have less number of ACE2 receptors on the alveolar cell surfaces as compared to adults, therefore they are less likely to be infected. Whereas adults have been shown to have a much higher number of ACE2 receptors, which are the entry points of the virus, and also the adults generate a cytokine storm-like immune response in order to fight the infection. As a result, they are more severely affected than children.
Suppose a person gets infected today, then how long will the infection last?
I can give you an estimation of this. A COVID-19 infection can generally last for about 14 days. For the first 4 to 6 days, the virus incubates in the human body. During this, it starts waking up its soldiers or immune cells to fight the developing infection, and therefore the symptoms start appearing. In some cases of very severe infection, patients experience a cytokine storm as the body continues to extensively fight the infection. This can be fatal if untreated because a very high immune response can start targeting and destroying normal, healthy cells of infected individuals. Most people who reach day 14 without any worrying symptoms are likely to be on their road to recovery and can come out of isolation 3 days after testing negative by RT-PCR. However, in some patients, the infection can last for more than 14 days, and in some cases, long COVID-like conditions that last for several months after the onset of recovery and several complications can also arise. The symptoms include cough, breathlessness, fatigue, body pains, fever relapse and headaches, secondary fungal infections such as the black fungus disease or mucormycosis.
Oh my God, this COVID-19 infection can get very serious. Tell me, how do I protect myself from catching this infection?
Don't be scared. It is very easy to protect yourself from it. Since the coronavirus spreads through droplets in the air and can be present on surfaces,
we need to use a mask properly,
maintain appropriate social distance of more than 6 feet in public places, maintain proper hand hygiene, and sanitize the frequently touched surfaces. Maintaining proper ventilation in closed spaces where people sit or work together can also help. But most importantly, get yourself vaccinated against COVID-19.
You just mentioned about vaccine, right? How does getting a vaccine protect me?
You know, anything that enters the human body is seen as an enemy or antigen by the body's defense or immune system. The immune system now sends out soldiers or immune cells with weapons or antibodies to fight or neutralize the antigen. After neutralizing the antigen, some of the immune cells specialize to become memory cells and remember the antigen to produce antibodies rapidly in case of future infections. When the body sees a new antigen, such as the SARS-CoV-2 virus, the immune system has no antibody ready against it. This vaccine acts as a messenger carrying information about the virus, and the body prepares an army of memory cells against it. The messenger can be of three types. Number one, the whole virus inactivated by heat or chemicals, for example, the Covaxin. Number two, a vaccine can also be made by only a subpart of the virus which is incapable of infecting, for example, the Covishield. And number three, the genetic material of the virus can also be used, for example, the Pfizer and the Moderna vaccines. Another vaccine, the Sputnik V, is a hybrid of the type 1 and 3 messengers.
Wait. There are so many vaccines. So which vaccine should I choose?
So far, the government of India has approved 3 vaccines, the Covishield, Covaxin and Sputnik V, all of which are safe and effective. You should register yourself on Covin and get yourself vaccinated with whichever vaccine available at your nearest vaccination site. And do remember to follow government guidelines for your vaccination schedule.
Can you tell me, how will I know that I am infected with coronavirus?
A person who gets infected by the virus may experience symptoms such as cough, phlegm, loss of sense of smell, shortness of breath, fever, muscle and joint pain, headache and fatigue. Abdominal pain, vomiting and diarrhea are also very common. It is possible that a person is infected but still has no symptoms. Then he or she would be asymptomatic. If a person experiences any of the above symptoms, he or she must get themselves tested.
How shall I know it's a COVID-19 infection and not a common cold?
Since the COVID-19 and common cold have similar symptoms, it's best to consult a doctor and get an RT-PCR test done upon their recommendation. Till the tested person gets an RT-PCR report, they must stay isolated.
I have heard that a rapid antigen test takes less time than an RT-PCR. So why do I get an RT-PCR test done?
Though an RT-PCR takes longer time, it tells you about the severity of the disease and is indicative of an ongoing infection. A rapid antigen test takes less time. However, it only tells you about the presence or absence of the infection, but it does not tell you about the severity of the disease.
Then how is rapid antibody test different from the rapid antigen test?
A rapid antibody test is indicative of past infections because it detects antibody made by the body against the virus, whereas the rapid antigen test is indicative of a current infection because it detects the virus in the body.
Isn't it true that people get a CT scan done for COVID-19 infection? When should a CT scan be done?
When an RT-PCR test value is below 25 and the person has accompanying shortness of breath, it recommends the CT scan of the lung. A CT scan must be performed on doctor recommendations because it exposes a person to harmful radiation hazards.
So what does a CT scan detect?
The CT scan of the lung detects severity of inflammation, clot formation, accumulation of fluid in the alveolar spaces, and scarring of the lung tissues.
Okay, I understand. Suppose I have tested COVID-19 positive. Then, when do I need to get admitted to the hospital?
Based on the results of the recommended tests and the infected person's symptoms, the doctor will assess the severity of the disease and advise whether the person needs to be isolated at home or needs hospitalization. In many cases, patients recover well, even in home isolation, by just following the doctor's prescription of medicines. As per the ICMR guidelines, the doctor may advise patients with mild symptoms to be treated in home isolation, whereas patients with moderate disease may be advised hospitalization. In case the symptoms are severe, the patient may need to be admitted to an ICU.
Can I take some medicines on my own to treat COVID-19 infection?
No, you must not take any medicines without consulting your doctor, because in patients who are self-medicating with steroids, the immune system becomes excessively suppressed and they become prone to bacterial and fungal infections, specifically the black fungus infection or mucormycosis, which can be fatal.
I have heard that patients also use oxygen cylinders during home isolation. When is an oxygen cylinder needed?
Yes, you are right. During home isolation, if the patient experiences shortness in breath or low blood oxygen levels, in consultation with his or her doctor, the patient can use an oxygen cylinder. The procedure for using an oxygen cylinder is explained in the schematic on the screen, and you must consult the doctor before using it.
But I still have some more questions to ask.
Well, to answer your further questions, we have with us today a famous virologist and our respected director, Dr. Sudhanshu Vrithi. Let us take his opinions regarding the same.
People are saying, do you think that there will be a third wave of the infection?
As of now, it looks highly probable that we will have the third wave of infection. It is very difficult to correctly predict when and what would be the extent of third wave. So the best way is to continue to, you know, exercise COVID appropriate behavior, wear mask, keep safe distance, and keep washing hands. This is the only way to avoid, if you want to avoid, the third wave.
So, sir, as this wave is declining, do we still need to maintain the COVID appropriate behavior?
As I said, yes, for obvious reason, because there is every likelihood that we will have a next wave coming. So to avoid that wave from, you know, causing severe damage to our population, it is best to continue with COVID appropriate behavior.
Sir, the scientists and doctors are saying that vaccine is the best option to protect ourselves from this disease. Do we need to take the vaccine then?
Of course, this is the best option for infectious diseases. Vaccines have proven to be boon. The only solution to infectious diseases are vaccines. And thankfully, for SARS-CoV-2 also, the vaccine scientists have worked hard and they have produced several vaccines within a year. These vaccines are safe and their efficacy has been proven, so you must take vaccine.
So, sir, do I need to take the vaccine the next year also?
That is something that is not clear to us as of now, because these vaccines, their efficacy has been tested for short duration. Because the vaccines have been given the emergency use authorization. That means that there is a lot of studies yet to be done. So as of now, we do not know whether how long the vaccine effect is going to last. But it is possible that we might have to take another dose sometime next year.
So is there any other drug which is available by which we can prevent from this?
There is no drug to prevent it. There is no drug. There is no prophylactic available. There is no therapeutic available, really. So the only solution is to take vaccine. Vaccine is the only thing that will protect you.